Hey guys, I'm here at the Flint Public Library. I'm DEMCAD, as you guys know. I had an opportunity to listen to Edward McClelland's lecture on urban decline and urban renewal. He talked about Detroit, Chicago, Cleveland. He also talked about Buffalo. I found it to be very insightful. He's a wonderful author. He also authored a book, The Young Mr. Obama, which is available on Amazon. His new book, Nothing But Blue Skies, is also available at Amazon. And you guys, I want to give you guys a look at some of his lectures. So enjoy.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Flint Public Library and to the first in an exciting series of author events we're calling Reimagining Flint. I'm Kay Schwartz, director of the library. In a moment, we'll introduce our wonderful speaker for this evening, Edward McClelland. But first, I'd like to thank him for sparking interest in an entire series of author events that it will be upcoming over the next few months.
Edward McClelland, a big Flint supporter, as you can see, was actually born in Lansing, and he started his journalism career right there at the Lansing State Journal, and then moved on to become a staff writer in Chicago, where he resides today. He's the author of three other books, Young Mr. Obama, Horse Players, and The Third Coast, which won the 2008 Great Lakes Book Award. He's also written articles for the New York Times, LA Times, Salon, and Slate. Edward McClelland's latest book, Nothing But Blue Skies, The Heyday, Hard Times, and Hopes of America's Industrial Heartland, discusses the history and current economic issues facing cities all over the Rust Belt Midwest, including Flint, and how the people of each of these cities are coping. He was inspired to write this book when he was struck by the sights of a torn down Fisher Body plant right across from his old high school, which is probably an experience that many in this community have had similar to. Anyway, he's here to tell us more. Please welcome Edward McClelland.
Thanks everybody for coming and for your interest in this series. This is the biggest crowd I've had so far on my book tour. One of the things I want to talk about, and I talked about this a little bit in Detroit yesterday, was Flint has certainly been the subject of a lot of movies and books and magazine articles and newspaper articles. But I think one of the things you'll get out of reading this book is that it's not just Flint, that the forces, the social and the historical forces that are acting on Flint are acting on a lot of other cities in this region, and that what happens has happened in Flint is not the particular result of any particular Flint pathology or Flint mismanagement or malfeasance. What I want to do tonight is present a slideshow of some other cities I visited which have problems similar to Flint's and show some of the solutions that they've come up with to reinvent their cities and to become a successful post-industrial city. Some of the cities I went to, besides Flint, I wrote about Detroit, I wrote about Lansing, which is where I'm from, and as Rick mentioned, the Fisher Body Plant, which was across from my old high school, Sexton High School, was torn down, although that actually had a happier ending than a lot of other factory teardowns, because basically it and the jobs were replaced with the new plant in Delta Township, which you may have heard of. The problem with Fisher Body was that it was simply an obsolete arrangement. They were building the bodies and they had to truck them across town to the plant on the Grand River, and they wanted everything under one roof. So I visited Cleveland, I visited Buffalo, Syracuse, New York. I visited Youngstown, Ohio, Decatur, Illinois, which was where I was a newspaper reporter in the mid-1990s, while the A.E. Staley labor dispute was going on. And that was a defeat for organized labor that really probably didn't get a lot of publicity because it was happening in such an obscure place, which may have been one reason why the company thought it could come down so hard on the unions there. And then Chicago, where I live, and I think I was mentioning to Rick and Kay a statistic that I read just yesterday, which is that 56% of the in-migration to Cook County, Illinois, is from the state of Michigan. I mean, in Chicago, there are 13 or 14 Michigan state bars, which which may be more than there are in East Lansing. It's the number one destination. You're a Spartan. I'm a Spartan. It's the number one destination for recent graduates of Michigan State and the University of Michigan. And I was saying that the function of Michigan's university system now seems to be to give the brightest students a ticket out of the state. I mean, in the 2000s, Michigan went from 30th to 35th in the proportion of college graduates. So I think the state needs to come up with some sort of solution, such as forgiving at least a portion of student loans to people who stay in the state for 5 years after graduation, because basically Illinois is freeloading on Michigan's education system. I mean, the University of Michigan is ranked more highly than the University of Illinois, and they're getting the best graduates from the state of Michigan. Of course, I wonder how much longer the University of Michigan is going to be ranked as highly as it is, because this is really a legacy of when the state was an industrial powerhouse and had the money to attract the best professors and the best talent. I know one of the buildings there, I think it's called the Harlan Hatcher Library, and I think was he the one who was Henry Ford's lawyer? There's one building that was built by Henry Ford's lawyer. Henry Ford couldn't pay him, so he paid him in 5% of the stock in Ford Motors, which turned out to be much better than getting the fee that he was entitled to. So I think the city I want to start with is Buffalo, because Buffalo is really the mother of Great Lakes cities and the mother of Rust Belt cities, because Buffalo sort of set the pattern for what you see in a lot of these big cities with, you know, these churches built around ethnic neighborhoods and taverns. And Buffalo was the first city on the Great Lakes to achieve national prominence. And it was really the first city to sort of go downhill, because what Buffalo was the connection between the Great Lakes system and the Atlantic. It was the terminus of the Erie Canal. So you'd ship things to Buffalo and then they'd go on the Erie Canal to New York. And once they built the St. Lawrence Seaway, Buffalo was bypassed. Buffalo had lost its position. And I took a boat trip on the Buffalo River, which I wrote about in the Third Coast, and I also write about here. And every turn in the river, you see these huge grain elevators that have just been abandoned. And I don't have a picture of this, but I can describe it. And they're too expensive to tear down. So they've been doing light shows on the sides of these giant grain elevators. They painted them white, and so they've been projecting things on there. So at least they're getting some entertainment out of it. Let me show you. This is a map of the far northwest side of Buffalo. And this is kind of an example of how industry can be a negative legacy in some ways, a legacy hard to get out from underneath. In the 1950s, this is the Niagara River, and this is Riverside Park, which was designed by Frederick Law Olmsted, who was also the designer of Central Park. This was his last commission. And so in the 1950s, the Niagara River was not an attractive place. It was polluted with effluent from the steel mills, from the tanneries. It's where the brothels were, where the saloons were, where the sailors hung out. So people didn't want to live on the river. And this is something you're probably familiar with, an urban planner named Robert Moses, who is the subject of the book The Master Builder by Robert A. Caro. And Robert Moses would have built a highway over his grandmother's grave. That was the fastest route from Manhattan to Albany. He would let nothing stand in his way of building a road. And so he built Interstate I-190 right along the Niagara River. And nobody minded back then, because nobody wanted to live on the river. But what it did was it cut Riverside Park off from the river. So it's not really Riverside Park anymore. It's I-90 Side Park. And to get to the river, you have to walk over a skywalk. And then there's this little strip of grass literally about this big. And this is all the Buffalo has left of its river. So there are people there who would love to move I-90 to the west side of town, because now, I mean, water is seen as an amenity. People want to live near the water. I mean, if you can sell a condominium with a view of the water, you can sell it for more money than if it's inland, if it's blind to the lake or to the river. And so people are really trying to reconnect with the water. And there's actually a GM plant just north of here in Tonawanda. And this was, a lot of the workers lived in this neighborhood back then. But of course, once they had the highway, they didn't have to live there anymore. And so they moved out to the suburbs. And so it had the effect of really degrading not only Riverside Park, but the Riverside neighborhood. So Buffalo is really struggling to rediscover its waterfront. And I'll show you a picture. This is a little bit of what they've done. They have a naval museum. They have a boardwalk. They uncovered part of the original terminus of the Erie Canal. You know how the song goes, all the way from Albany to Buffalo. I've got a mule, her name is Sal, on the Erie Canal. And you know, they have ships come in, tall ships come in. And their model is Baltimore's Inner Harbor, although they don't have quite as much to work with. There's another highway system called the Buffalo Skyway, and it kind of overarches near the river, and it also cuts people off from the waterfront. So they're doing what they can, but they can't do as much as a lot of other cities did. This was the Bethlehem Steel. This is what remains of the Bethlehem Steel plant. This probably looks familiar if you're from Flint. This closed down in December of 1982, right after Christmas. They always announce these closings right after Christmas so they won't spoil anybody's holiday. They just spoil the rest of their life. And really, nothing has gone on there since then. I want to talk about something. I went there. And I took a wildflower book with me. I bought a wildflower book before I visited this site because there are certain kinds of plants that I found grow on all kinds of industrial sites. It's like they grow on the graves of factories. I saw them at the Fisher Body plant, and I've seen them here at Buick City in Flint. And some of this is Peterson's First Guide to Wildflowers of Northeastern and North Central North America. And some of them, in some of the descriptions, I'll specify that they're found in waste spaces, which is what this would be. Some of the things I found were spotted knapweed, goldenrod, chicory, yarrow, mayweed, toadflax. So if you want to entertain yourself for an afternoon, you might get a wildflower book and walk among some of the sites in Flint, because it's an interesting naturalistic excursion. And as someone I met in Syracuse told me, he said, nature always bats last. No matter what we build, nature is finally going to have its way with it. And this is eventually going to be the way of everything on Earth. The Homestead Works in Homestead, Pennsylvania. Homestead is directly across the Cuyahoga River from Pittsburgh, right south of Pittsburgh. And Homestead, I say in the book, has more history per square mile than any other city in America. This is the site of the 1892 Homestead steel strike, when there was a shootout between Pinkerton guards and strikers. Where Mother Jones came to organize steel workers in 1919. It was the birthplace of the Homestead Grays Negro League baseball team. And but this mill, it was once the largest steel mill in the world. It provided the steel for the Brooklyn Bridge, for the Apollo program, for the U.S. Navy. So it really helped build the American century. But in 1988, I think it was, it closed down. And after it closed, there was a man, a professor at Carnegie Mellon, who had bought a house in Homestead and was interested in revitalizing the city. And he looked at a map of the Pittsburgh area, and he noticed that as a result of urban sprawl, Homestead was in the dead center of Pittsburgh. And he said, well, this could be a tourist attraction. And he got the idea to build a mall there. And this was the first industrial site to be completely remediated by the state of Pennsylvania. But in the meantime, after it had gone out of business, Homestead went broke. Homestead became a ward of the state of Pennsylvania in the way that Flint is becoming a ward of the state of Michigan. And it couldn't pay its bills, couldn't pay its police force. I think it was even policed by the state. I mean, it lost all its entire tax base. So this is, okay, this is the waterfront mall, and it's just a pretty typical outdoor mall. It's got things like the Lone Star Steakhouse and Bed Bath & Beyond and Dave & Buster's and the AMC Multiplex. And they left this here as a remnant of what was once there. So now most people in Pittsburgh, if they think of Homestead, they don't think of steel. They think of shopping. So, and of course, this did not replace the jobs that had been at the Homestead Mill. I'm sure these people who were in retail are making $9, $10 an hour, but it did provide a tax base to rescue Homestead financially. And Homestead is once again solvent. So the steel mill jobs were not going to come back, and so this was the best that they could do. Flint here. People probably remember when this was the Hyatt region. Was it the Hyatt? And it was, as it was described to me, when they went in to renovate it, it was just knee-deep in garbage and detritus. And I think a real important thing that Flint did was to get the University of Michigan Flint as a residential campus here. Because it, I mean, not only brings life back to downtown, it gets young people who are going to be educated in college used to the idea of living in downtown Flint and maybe get some interest in the idea of staying in Flint. And one of the people that I interviewed was now Congressman Dan Kildee. And I'm talking about ideas that other cities have for Flint, but he had an idea that's been a Flint idea for the rest of the region, which was the land bank. He's really considered the father of the land bank movement, and it was something that Cleveland ended up copying fairly effectively, to buy land and to put new houses on it or to sell it to neighbors to look after. Has anyone ever been to the corner of North and McClelland where they have the 9/11 Memorial Corner? Is anyone familiar with that? Okay. I was trying to get a hold of the people who ran it, but their phone number isn't working anymore. I might go up there to see if I can find them. But I mean, that's a case of, just on a very ground level case, of neighbors taking care of abandoned land. And that's, they bought some of those lots for, I think, as little as $25 or $50. And that's something that could probably exist only in a city like Flint or Detroit, where there is that much empty land, and where the city or the county has managed to get a hold of it and get it into the hands of people will look after it and not just let it go to seed. And I'll read you a little bit about what Dan Kildee did. Elected county treasurer in 1996, Kildee quickly discovered that Flint was a major market for tax lien speculators. Lured by the instant wealth promises of late night infomercials, investors, or bottom feeders as Kildee came to call them, would buy liens on abandoned properties in bulk. If the owners paid, the bottom feeders made a 15% return. If the owners didn't pay, the bottom feeders foreclosed. As long as the land was worth more than its delinquent taxes, the bottom feeders could profit. The lien was a 19th century system designed to ensure that government could get cash quickly without waiting for tax payments. For pre-post-industrial Flint, liens were a disaster, putting houses into the possession of absentee owners who let them go to seed. Kildee's office stopped the speculation by borrowing money equal to all the delinquent taxes and paying local governments what they owed. The county became the tax speculator and the landlord, renting out salvageable houses. In 1999, Kildee convinced the state legislature to change the tax law, allowing counties to foreclose on properties. This led to the establishment of the Genesee County Land Bank, giving the community ownership of its vacant houses and lots. The land bank has demolished 15,000 houses and sold nearly 1,000 lots to neighbors. Genesee County became a model for other communities that suddenly found themselves with more land than anyone wanted. In the words of Cleveland's Jim Rokakis, he was the Cuyahoga County Treasurer, the father of the land bank movement in this county is Dan Kildee, but he will tell you that the Ohio Land Bank is the Michigan statute on steroids. They led the way, and we got to tweak it. And in Cuyahoga County, Cleveland ended up having that was sort of where the foreclosure crisis was born. And one of the points I want to make in this book is that the cultural and intellectual trends may start on the East and the West Coast, but the nation's economic trends start here in the Midwest. This is the birthplace of the middle class, and it's been the graveyard of the middle class. And in Cleveland, especially in a neighborhood called Slavic Village, that kind of became the capital of foreclosures in America. There were a lot of old people moving out or dying, and their kids lived in the suburbs, and they weren't interested in the houses, and so then a lot of these speculators came in and bought them up, and they were running scams like pricing a house for $90,000 and selling it for $50,000 and pocketing the difference. And I think Cuyahoga County had a higher percentage of houses in foreclosure than anywhere else in the United States. Now, Ohio has very weak banking laws. This was where Countrywide Financial got its start, and they were giving no verification loans to people. And also, it was because people were losing their jobs, and these people were going around and saying, "Hey, you still have a source of money. You can borrow money on your house." Or they would go around and say, "Hey, look, your roof is falling apart. Somebody's going to call the city," suggesting that they may be the ones to call the city if you don't fix it, and we'll give you a loan to do it. So that put a lot of people on the hook. This was the U.S. This is a model. This was the U.S. Steel site in Chicago, and this is the last piece of undeveloped lakefront land in the city of Chicago. The U.S. Steel plant closed in the mid-1980s, and Wisconsin Steel closed in around the same time. And as I talk about in this book, and I've got another book called Young Mr. Obama, Chicago and the Making of a Black President, that's what ultimately brought Obama to Chicago. Because after these steel mills closed, the Catholic Church started a group to work with laid-off steel workers to counsel them. And they needed an organizer to work in their inner city chapter, and so someone put an ad in a community organizing magazine called Community Jobs, and Obama read it in the New York Public Library, answered it, and came to Chicago. And if he hadn't answered that ad, he wouldn't be president today. Because if he hadn't come to Chicago, he wouldn't be president today. So this was, they built this, the U.S. Steel kind of built itself out on slag. It kept dumping more slag into the lake until there was 500 acres of slag. And you can't dig in slag, and you can't grow anything in slag. So they're going to have to build all these with no basements. And they also had to find dirt. So a problem they were having on the Illinois River was it was all mucked up around Peoria, and it was interfering with barge traffic. So they dredged the river, put it on barges, floated up to Chicago,
site of the old Midwest Steel plant.
So they're hoping this can rescue the neighborhood. I mean, it's lakefront property. It's convenient to downtown, so they're hoping it's going to be the kind of place the middle class is going to want to live in Chicago. There was also a concert by the Dave Matthews Band on the old U.S. Steel site, which attracted about 20,000 people, which is the most people who've been there since 20,000 people were working in the plant during World War II. So, I have a couple chapters about Chicago in here. And it's called "We're All Going to End Up in Chicago," which was something I heard a clerk at Schuller Books say. And someone in Cleveland asked me, "Well, what did Chicago do right to become kind of the city in the Midwest that made it?" And I think what she was asking was, "What can other cities do to emulate Chicago?" And kind of the conclusion I came to was that they can't really do anything, because in a lot of ways, as I was talking about before with the statistics of the in-migration to Cook County, Chicago's success really comes at the expense of the rest of the region. I mean, Chicago was already the Midwest financial capital, and it was more economically diversified than a lot of cities like Flint or Detroit or Cleveland. And so when the American economy shifted from manufacturing to finance, Chicago was in a perfect position to take advantage of that. And also, the first Mayor Daley made sure that Chicago remained the nation's transportation hub by building up O'Hare Airport. It's mostly focused on, I guess, on a municipal level. I mean, certainly I think one reason that Ohio had such a terrible foreclosure problem was that the state had such weak banking laws. I mean, one comment I will make is I don't think any state cities are in worse shape than Michigan's. And I think what's always been my wish, even this goes back 25 years, long before I wrote this, is that Detroit would do and Flint would do what Indianapolis and Toronto and Miami-Dade did, which was consolidate into a metropolitan area. I just don't see, you look at Detroit, I don't even think it's a functioning city anymore. I don't see how 700,000 poor people can support infrastructure built for 1.8 million people. And people say, well, what's in it for the suburbs? Well, just last week we heard that they might have to sell off their world-class art collection. And that's a resource for the entire region. So I mean, a stronger central city is good for, it's good for everybody, and it's good for the municipality's image, and it's good for the state's image. Yeah.
Well, on the flyer, it says in your book that you talk about how the people of each city view themselves.
Right.
Can you speak on that?
Well, I could talk about Cleveland. I mean, Cleveland thinks a lot more about what the rest of the country thinks about Cleveland than the rest of the country actually thinks about Cleveland. Cleveland is just this city that walks around with a cloud over its head. You know, they think there were the Burning River jokes, and there was a situation where the mayor's hair caught on fire, and Dennis Kucinich taking the city almost into bankruptcy, and now recently LeBron James leaving Cleveland for Miami. So I think someone asked me which city has a better chance of coming back, Buffalo or Cleveland, and I think I said, you know, if you put just a random group of people in each one, I'd say Cleveland, but because Cleveland is full of Clevelanders, I have to say Buffalo. So I think Cleveland in particular has a poor self-image. An interesting thing I found about Detroit is that it's impossible to write anything for someone outside Detroit to write anything about Detroit without someone inside Detroit commenting on what the outsider wrote about Detroit. So I think Detroit is kind of touchy in that way, and I kind of felt like it was kind of a no-win situation writing about Detroit, because you're either a naive idealist writing about how these young urban pioneers or this barbecue joint is going to save Detroit, or you're a ruined pornographer writing about the city's ruins. So those are two of the interesting civic psyches that I found on my trip.
And then as a follow-up, so how do you think you can change that image? So for Flint, going through the master planning process, one of the clear obstacles, as I see it, is the image that the city has, especially to outsiders. Mm-hmm. So what would you recommend as far as changing the city's image?
Let's see. Tape up Michael Moore's mouth. Would that help? Well, I think people need to know. People need to see what's successful. I mean, people from the outside need to see what's successful in downtown Flint, because Flint certainly does make a lot of sensationalistic headlines. I mean, you have the highest murder rate in the nation. I mean, one statistic I calculated was that if New York City had the same murder rate as Flint, it would have 5,000 murders a year. So, I mean, I think you have to find a way of showing people where Flint has succeeded, showing people that the difference between downtown Flint 20 years ago and the difference between downtown Flint today, and talk about and how it's trying to rebuild from the outside, from the inside. I mean, that was Dan Kildee's scheme, I guess. And he said, you know, we can't compete with the suburbs. We need to offer people an urban experience.
That you think might be a lesson for Flint.
I think Pittsburgh did. I mean, I think Pittsburgh kind of saw the steel crisis coming and managed to reinvent itself pretty well. And Pittsburgh is in pretty good shape. I mean, in Chicago in 1980, I quoted a newspaper article in which the writer said Chicago is headed in the same direction as Buffalo, Cleveland, and Detroit, and it's going to end up the same way. And Chicago managed to find a way out. But as I said before, its success has kind of been inimitable for the for the region. So one of the consequences of globalization is that, you know, money and education become concentrated among fewer people and also among fewer cities. And Chicago has been the big winner in the Midwest. But, you know, I just think Michigan needs to take a look at, and this is something government can do. This is a political problem. It needs to take a look at the boundaries of its urban areas. I mean, most of these cities stopped growing about 1920. And as the population spread out, the wealth just left the central cities. I mean, townships are a terrible legacy. Townships they were meant to exist for maybe 50 years. They're completely obsolete. And they prevent cities from growing. So, I mean, I think, but there's so many political, I mean, you go to Lansing, there's a Michigan Association of Townships. So once you create these elected positions, it's really hard to get rid of them, to dislodge people from them. Chicago, when someone asked the question, why didn't Chicago turn into Detroit? And the guy giving the presentation said, well, parts of it did. You know, on the west side and the south side. I mean, you have this global city in the core. You know, this is where all the former Spartans and Wolverines move, and they can take the train, and they're close to their bars, and they're close to the fancy restaurants. And then, I mean, I was looking at census data, and there was a census tract where the average income was $120,000, and then you went 2 miles west, and it was $20,000.
But the south side is also huge manufacturing, just...
Well, it was.
Was, yeah.
Well, there's still a Ford plant there on Torrance Avenue. So it's, I mean, it is still the most industrial, but that's the far south side.
Yeah.
Just kind of talking about more than the near south side. So yeah, I mean, certainly there's a real dichotomy in Chicago. So I'll take a couple more questions here. You can.
Well, I just want to say that one of the things that I think Flint has going for it is stock of very interesting homes
right.
that are a legacy also of earlier times when the middle class was strong, and I work at U of M Flint, and I have occasion to talk to incoming faculty people or candidates for faculty positions, and I always say that, you know, you can get a great house here for really cheap, and if there are children that come with that, or if there are young people that come with that, it can be a marvelous thing. However, and in the neighborhood that I live in, like a number of us do, over in the cultural center neighborhood, the street that we live on has become populated with young families over the 10 years that we've had a house there. But none of those, I think we counted up that there are like 15 kids or something on our block now, which is just remarkable.
That's great.
But none of them go to the public school. There's a beautiful little school within walking distance, and then there's Central High School, which is this gorgeous building that used to be the center of this community,
mm-hmm.
and it's a ghost. It's an empty ghost, you know. It's just like, that just grieves me every time I walk around by Central High School. It just grieves me that place that used to be so vital is gone. So what are these young families supposed to do? They get these nice, lovely homes that they can afford now, but they have to solve this problem of what to do about their children.
Yeah, and admittedly, you know, one of the reasons that Chicago held on to its middle class was because Chicago was such a Catholic town. They sent their kids to the Catholic schools. All the white Protestants moved to the suburbs. I mean, what schools are they going to here? Are they going to the Catholic schools?
Some of them are homeschooling.
Really?
Some of them, yeah. Like, I don't have kids, so I can't really say.
Okay.
Like, if I had kids, I probably would be making the same decisions you do. But
right.
If you figure out 15 kids from four different homes, that's almost enough for a class up at Pierce, you know. I just wish that there was enough of a critical mass that people could go back into public schools and sort of demand change. But
well, and I think that's happened in Chicago. But as I said, I don't think there is enough of a critical mass here to have like a magnet high school or magnet elementary schools.
They go to parochial schools.
Right.
Or I don't know. It's just a combination. None of them have come up with the same solution. So the other thing is these little kids that all live next door to each other, none of them go to the same school.
Okay, so it's not a community. No.
It's a neighborhood.
Right.
But not associated with the school. And
Hi guys, thank you for watching, thank you for listening, I hope you enjoyed the lecture. Again, you can find this book, Nothing But Blue Skies, available at Amazon. There's a link below. You can check it out. And also, he also came to Flint before, where I spoke with him on a number of other issues as well. Yeah, you can check out the videos as well. So, guys, again, thank you for watching. Thank you for listening. And don't forget, the future belongs to those who prepare for today. Question of the day, why should people care about urban areas, and how can urban areas serve as a catalyst for a revival of the middle class in this current century?